there is. All right. Okay. All righty, next slide. So Victor Hugo, who wrote Les Miserables, that was a it's been on Broadway for a long time. Love the music. And it was a book, of course. And the Hunchback of Notre Dame said, "Music expresses that which cannot be put into words, and that which cannot remain silent." So we know that when we hear certain songs, it touches our soul or our spirit in a way that we can't express in words, but we know what it makes us feel. So that's the power of music. Next, thank you, Beth. All right, so we're gonna guess. If anybody wants to guess and unmute, this is a hard one because then we have to unmute, but can anybody guess what this next first song will be? Yeah, it's a tough one, but I think Polly's coming forward. Let's see.
Climb Every Mountain.
Oh, that's a good song. I love
That's not
that.
the right one.
But Polly, it should be Climb Every Mountain, and I can't sing that song because it's too high for my voice. But this land is your land. And I really want to look at this for a second before we sing it. We know the song, we know the words. I'm going to show you the words. But this song actually was a reaction to the song written by Irving Berlin called God Bless America. You know that. God bless America, land that I love. That song. Well, Woody Guthrie did not like that song. He thought it was naive because America was going through so many troubles at the time, so much hunger, so much issues with climate. He came from Oklahoma, the Dust Bowl. So a lot of those things that he was experiencing 80 years ago, we're also experiencing now. And he had a verse that I'm going to read to you before we sing. That was not did not become the part of the recording. This is what he wrote. And you think about it, whether we can relate now. One bright sunny morning in the shadow of the steeple by the relief office, I saw my people as they stood hungry. I stood there wondering if God blessed America for me. So this was his reaction to what he saw as he traveled across America and the struggles of folks like they are in our day. So, the verses that remained are the ones we're going to sing now. Next slide. Thank you, Beth.
Stream waters, this land
next slide, I want to say one of the criticisms about Woody Guthrie's song was that he did not include the Native people who were here before everyone else arrived. And so there was that criticism that he didn't acknowledge Indigenous folks being here on the land. But he went out and was advocating on their behalf throughout his life. So I just thought I would bring in some of this stuff because we're singing songs of folk songs, spiritual songs, protest songs.
Thank you, Marjie. That was beautiful. I'm hearing a little distortion at some of the moments. I don't know if it's just my volume, but maybe if you move back just slightly, it may be being a little close to the speakers. Would you try that? Is that okay?
Oh, sure. And Josh, what do you think?
I was just sending you a message. I was going to say that if you want to turn down the input volume on your audio settings just slightly, that might actually help because I just...
How do I do that?
So if you go to your settings and then to the audio on the... Do you know how to open up your settings?
No.
Okay. So next to your mute button, there's that little carrot.
This is a musical from Broadway, and I do know that you know the music. It's called Oh, What a Beautiful Morning, and it's from Oklahoma, and it was the first musical written by Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein. The stage production was in 1943, and the film was in 1955. And this is Gordon McRae. And Shirley Jones was in it as well. And Shirley Jones was in The Partridge Family, for any of those who remember that show. So please join me because it is a beautiful morning today and we're gonna see if the sound is better. So there's a bright golden haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as an elephant's eye. Looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way. And now I'm turning the page. All the cattle are standing like statues. All the cattle are standing like statues. They don't turn their heads as they see me ride by. But a little brown maverick is winking her eye. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way. Next slide. All the sounds of the earth are like music. All the sounds of the earth are like music. The breeze is so busy, it don't miss a tree. And an old weeping willow is laughing at me. One more time. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way. Oh, what a beautiful day. Oh, what a beautiful day. All right, how does that sound? All right, awesome. Thank you, Josh. Now, this song is one of my favorites as a young person. Next page. Anybody know who this is? This is Bob Dylan, a young Bob Dylan. You know, for people who are younger, you may, you know, it's so funny how we don't necessarily see younger versions of some of the folks who are now older. Like, I never knew what Frank Sinatra exactly looked like as a young person because I grew up and he was older. This is a young Bob Dylan. He won the Nobel Prize for literature. I think that's for literature, but his poetry, his words, he was a voice of the 60s, and he was a voice of protest. And so this next song, which we won't go there yet, but he was... he's 80 years old now, Bob Dylan, and the song is Blowing in the Wind, which he wrote in 1962. And when you think about it, he was 21 years old when he wrote this song, which is so awesome. And I really want to highlight that, the voice of young people, and I love that the Brandeis students are here because we need all the voices of all the ages in order to really make change in our society and in our culture. And like I said, in 2016, he won the Nobel Prize in Literature. And thank God for Wikipedia. So Wikipedia says, although every day it changes, so you never know, that we don't even know what he was saying exactly, because his song, The Answer, My Friend, is Blowing in the Wind. Some people say that this is ambiguous. We don't know what it means. And so the answer is blowing in the wind can either be so obvious that it's right in front of our faces, or the answer is intangible as the wind. That's according to Wikipedia. So please, everybody, join me. And, you know, these were protest songs, big time. But as we got older in years past, they became campfire songs. Which is nice, because then we all learn these songs. But all these songs today that I'm sharing were lifting up a voice about something or other in the world that we live in. Here we go.
How many roads must man walk down before you call?
How many deaths will it take till he knows? breath, maybe we could pause here and just ask people if they feel like I'm muting or they want to share anything before we move on to the next part of this morning. Just want to take a breath.
And welcome to those who have just joined us. Welcome, Nina. We have Nina and Mina here today. And welcome to Marilyn and Rick. And there's somebody with an 888 phone number who I don't know who you are, and I'd love to know. So if you want to unmute yourself and say hello, please feel free. Okay. So does anybody have thoughts about the Bob Dylan song or the songs that we've sung so far?
And we'll have time at the end to talk, but just wanted to give you a chance.
I'm curious if these songs are familiar to the Brandeis students.
That's a great question. Ah, thank you, Benjamin. Good.
My guess, as soon as I saw the picture of the mountains and the lake, was that we were going to do This Land Was Your Land.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's great.
That's awesome.
It's amazing the way some songs just reverberate through generation after generation. And they take on different meaning at different times, but they're so powerful that they stay with us. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Josh?
I really appreciate the way that these lyrics are written out in particular, because when I've looked up the lyrics for this song to share, it doesn't say yes and how many, like yes and. And I feel like the yes and part of the lyrics are very important, because if you don't know the song super well from memory and you're just learning it from the chords or from the lyrics and you just keep singing how many, it sounds like a much more interrogative, like sort of argumentative question, instead of this, which is acknowledging the person's answer, whatever that answer might be. Yes, and how many? Yes, and how many? And so I really appreciate that. And I think that there's just a subtle but very real difference in the way that that's laid out and sort of what that opens up for the way that we get to experience it as the audience and as people who are singing along. So thank you for that attention to detail. Wow. I've never experienced it that way.
Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah, that's really powerful, because obviously Bob Dylan wrote it this way. So then it gets changed and it changed the meaning. Thank you. Thank you for that. All right. So now we're going to go on to, we're going to go on to just a moment to breathe. Okay. We're just going to stop. We're going to pause. And one of my favorite meditation teachers, Zen masters, person that's really, really influenced my life is Thich Nhat Hanh from Vietnam. He's a Zen master. He's still alive. He's in his 90s. And he's a poet and a peace activist. And a couple of things I want to say about him is that Martin Luther King Jr. in 1967 nominated him for the Nobel Peace Prize. He didn't win, but the two of them, Thich Nhat Hanh, who was in America at the time, and Martin Luther King Jr., they had a strong friendship. And Thich Nhat Hanh influenced Dr. King with regard to the Vietnam War and how problematic it was, to say the least. So I want to mention that. I also want to say I love the conversation about the fall and the leaves. And I think it was Polly who said, which I agree, she would like the autumn more if the winter didn't come. I don't love the cold. But the reality is that the dark part of the year, and today is the new moon, so this is one of the darkest times. The sky is dark. So much can happen during the dark times, with the earth, what's growing underneath, as well as for our lives. Sometimes when we're going through a difficult time, that's what comes before we start to feel like the brightness comes and the light comes. And so Thich Nhat Hanh has a book called No Mud, No Lotus, meaning without the mud, without the underground and the earth, we can have not the beauty of the lotus. So it's both and I just want to share that. So this is one of his meditations, and when I say smile, see if you can actually smile, because we know that when you make your face into a smile, even if you don't feel that joyful, it sends all these neurons and, you know, the dopamine, and it makes you feel better. So I'm going to use the bell, and I'm going to sound the bell, and then I'm going to lead us in this meditation twice. As we breathe in, breathing in, I calm my body. And breathing out, I smile. Breathing in, dwelling in the present moment. Breathing out, I know this is a wonderful moment. One more time, breathing in. I calm my body. I'm breathing out, I smile. Breathing in, I'm dwelling in the present moment. Breathing out, I know this is a wonderful moment because we are all together. So let's go on to our next song. All right, so these are all my favorites. I'm going to give a chance if anybody wants to guess. Benjamin? I know, this is a tough one. So this is a beautiful picture of our beautiful planet, and the song that we're going to be singing is a gospel song, a traditional song. Yes. Yes, he's got the whole world in his hands. Oh, we are the world. I love that. Could be either one. He's got the whole world in his hands. And, you know, this is a great song because it really connects us to whatever we want to be connected to. It has a feeling of transcendence. It could be God. It could be something greater than ourselves, such as nature. We talked a lot about the transcendent power of nature. Benjamin really spoke beautifully about being in the forest, which is such a meditative place, and walking down. There was an image you had, like of a, it wasn't a highway. It was a, what was it, but Benjamin?
A tunnel.
A tunnel. Thank you. Love that. A tunnel. And it's a place of such beauty where you're surrounded in the woods by that sense of nature, the trees. And so it can also be a sense of transcendence with other being with other humans or with animals. Beth shared earlier, she just got two new kitties. It can be anything that brings you a sense of awe outside of yourself and connected to something larger. So let's get going with the first slide. And does it sound okay? Okay, awesome. First slide. Yeah, okay. I also want to say about this song before we start, many religions sing this song. It was a spiritual that was very popular in the hymnal in the 20s. It got recorded around the 1950s. It became a number one hit in 1958. And it was used in the 60s and the 50s with peace and civil rights activists. And apparently, it's the only gospel song to hit number one in the United States in 1958. And finally, this I love. It's a favorite in the football in Britain. I have no idea why, but that's what it says on Wikipedia. So, pretty popular song. Here we go. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby. Next slide. gonna end with the tambourine. I always like to say this is Miriam's tambourine. Miriam the prophet had a tambourine that she carried across as they crossed to freedom. All right. Next song. All right. So this is a ritual that we almost got there, right? We almost got there to the World Series. We did really well this year. And ritual is really, really important. Ritual is what makes us human, which helps us make meaning in our lives. And it's different for everybody, what offers them meaning. But one ritual that we share in common in this where we live, is the ritual of marking birthdays. So last month, I heard there was a birthday this week. Arnetta, right? Was it your birthday this week? Carl and Arnetta are on here. Let's see where they are. Are you guys there? Are you folks there, Arnetta and Carl?
They actually sent me a message that they had to step away for a moment.
We'll wait until they come back. Awesome. Yeah. Thank you, Beth. So let's go to the next. Before we go to the lyrics, actually, I just want to tell you one thing about baseball is in 1908, more than 100 years ago, this song was written because there was surging national interest in baseball. And so it made this song an instant success. And it's the unofficial theme song today of this spectator sport. I am a Bostonian. I grew up in Boston. Loved going to Fenway Park as a kid. So baseball is the sport I feel connected to. Here we go. Next slide. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack.
Ed is here, who is our resident baseball expert, longtime umpire. So I would be remiss if I didn't ask Ed if he could share any thoughts with us about how we cope with what happened with the World Series. Maybe you have some wisdom or perspective to share with us. Any thoughts about that, Ed? Yeah, we were all hopeful and we came close, but maybe we'll come back to Ed again later.
It's hard to isn't it hard to unmute on the phone?
I think it can be, yeah. And also since I can't see Ed, I don't know if, you know, he might have had to step away, so we won't put him on the spot.
All right, awesome. All right, let's see the next photo. Oh, yes, this is first. Thank you. Thank you. So John Oliver was the conductor and founder of Tanglewood Festival Chorus. And this is a quote from him. When singing together, which we're doing the best we can, we are united in the creative process and the barriers in our lives that prevent us from connecting with one another are overcome. You know, there used to be, I don't know if any of you remember, singing together, you know, singing in certainly at camps or Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, those kinds of things, but also just people got together and sang together. Someone played the piano, maybe. Someone played the guitar. Certainly when I was growing up, it was a big deal. That's why I learned the guitar, because everyone was playing the guitar and learned it as a young person. Everyone was sitting around singing together. And we know that when we sing together, our hormones, our endorphins are released. And when we sing with other people, this effect is really amplified. And there's some research that also shows that when we really start singing together, our hearts beat together. They start to synchronize our heartbeats with when we sing with other people, which I just find really, really profound. So let's see the next photo and see if anyone can guess what this song will be. All right. Well, if anyone wants to unmute or put it in the chat. All right. Well, this song is We Shall Overcome. Oh, Josh, perfect timing. Awesome. That was awesome. We Shall Overcome. And this song was written by Charles Albert Tinley. He was an African-American minister. He was the founding father of gospel song, and of music, and he wrote this hymn over 100 years ago in 1900. It was a protest song, and it became the key anthem of the civil rights movement. Pete Seeger sang it. Joan Baez sang it. They sang it at rallies. They sang it at folk festivals. And Charles Albert Tinley's father was a slave, and his mother was free. He considered himself free, but he grew up among enslaved people. So he understood what they were going through. And he wrote this song as a reaction to that. The other interesting thing about it is Pete Seeger will be singing a song of his next, another folk song protest writer. Pete Seeger changed one lyric to go back to what Josh was saying, the power of words. Originally, it was written as We Will Overcome. And Pete Seeger just changed one word to We Shall Overcome to make it better to sing. All right. So let's get the lyrics up there. Thank you, Beth.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday.
Yes, thank you, Beth.
We are not afraid. We are not afraid. We are not afraid today. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome.
I do believe that. I do believe that. Alrighty. You know, there's a great story about the monks in a monastery, and they ask, what do you do all day? And they say, we fall down, and then we get up. We fall down, and then we get up. We fall down, and then we get up. And I love that imagery of, we'll keep on trucking, as the Grateful Dead say. So that's the hope that we carry in our heart. All right, next song, Pete Seeger. So this was one of my favorite songs as a kid. This was another protest song. He wrote it in 1949. He was part of the group called The Weavers. The song became very famous when I was a kid in 1962 with Peter, Paul, and Mary. Johnny Cash recorded it in 1972. Aretha Franklin, the Queen of Soul, she recorded it. It was definitely a freedom song of the civil rights movement. And it's one of my favorites. If you know the song, If I Had a Hammer, raise your hand. All right. We have a lot of folks who know it. And if you don't know it, it's really easy to pick up. And it's another song about fighting for justice. All right. Let me make sure I have the right, yeah, I got it. Okay.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning, I'd hammer in the evening, all over this land. I'd hammer out danger, I'd hammer out a warning, I'd hammer out the love between my brothers and my sisters. All over this land. Oh, if I had a bell, I'd ring it in the morning, I'd ring it in the evening. All over this land, I'd ring out danger, I'd ring out a warning, I'd ring out the love between my brothers and my sisters.
Between all humans. That's our vision. The love between all humans. And you know, hope is an important emotion. And one of my favorite quotes about hope is the feeling you have that the feeling you have is not permanent. Meaning, if you're feeling down, hopefully it's going to change. If you're feeling happier, that also might change, that our emotions come and go. And hope is the feeling that the feeling, whatever it is that we have, is not permanent. Our emotions change and shift, and that's what makes us human. Okay.
I was listening to a podcast with the wonderful Brian Stevenson this morning, who is an attorney and a civil rights activist right now, and he always comes back to love and hope. Mm. And that love has to be the motivation that drives us all forward in everything that we do, and that hope is so important. And he says, it's really necessary for justice, because we have to keep feeling that we can make things better. So just on that note, hope and love.
Well, I love that, because actually my daughter is on her way to Alabama now with some of her colleagues to do a civil rights trip with some of her students, and they'll be visiting the museum that Bryan Stevenson started. It's, the colloquial name is the Lynching Museum, to really mark, Josh has got the quote from Jean about hope, about marking, about that, acknowledging that in our country. So thank you. And Bryan Stevenson also, his memoir, Just Mercy, is amazing. And he talks about, you know, just that we humans can be broken and whole, that we can be both and, that we can, that that's what it is to be human. And I love that about him, that he doesn't gloss it over. He says, you know, We deal with the brokenness, and we keep going forward with the hope and the love. I love that. Oh, here we go, Josh.
Yeah, there's the link to the podcast I was listening to this morning in the chat. Wonderful.
Bryan Stevenson's amazing. He got to hang out with Rosa Parks.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, and he said what he did, he just sat at her feet and listened. So he was invited to come be there and listen when Miss Parks and another friend were talking, because they were the elders, and his job was to learn from them as a younger man. And I love that too, the respect for elders, that there are so many lessons that come only with age. Mm. And he understands that.
Well, of course, I love that, Beth. And I will just add to that what I remember from that story when I read the memoir, his memoir, was they asked him, so Bryan, you know, he was the young one, so what are you doing these days? And he listed off everything, and they go, you're going to be really, 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 really tired if you don't take care of yourself.
Yep.
So I love that too, that they, you got to take care of yourself with all that you're doing. Awesome. Which is a message for all of us. Swing Low, Sweet Chariots, my next song. And I think this, look at this. Is this fabulous? This is by Wallace Willis. Not sure why it says that. Fitzpatrick, who knows, right? Well, I have it was written by Wallace Willis. Who knows? Well, we'll have to Google that one. What I know about this is that this song was written prior to 1862. This was prior to the Civil War. I mean, this is like unbelievable, these songs that still exist today.
I think it's who the painting is by.
Oh, thank you,
Beth. Yeah, is J. Kelly Fitzpatrick. But the song is by Wallace Willis.
Thank you. What an awesome painting. I love it, with all the chariots and the angels. So to tell you a little bit about this song, all right, Joan Baez sang it at Woodstock in 1969. Rugby players and their fans love the song in England. Again, I don't know what's going on in England. It's really interesting, all the spirituals they love. In 2011, this song became the official gospel song of Oklahoma. And the original Fisk Jubilee singers, they toured along the Underground Railroad around 1871. These are students from Fisk University, which was a historically black college in Nashville, Tennessee. And they were an a cappella, African-American a cappella group, and they sang this song. And then in 2000, to raise funds for the university. And in 2002, the Library of Congress honored their recording, adding it to the U.S. National Recording Registry, which I think is awesome. I've been to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and places like that. When you hear some old recordings of things that have survived of the early 1900s, it's amazing. And in the late 19th century, it was the most widely performed song of its kind. All right. How many of you know Swing Low, Sweet Chariot? All right. Got a lot of hands up there. So I invite you to sing along with me. Here we go. Got to get the right. Okay.
Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, chariot, coming for to carry me home. Well, I looked over Jordan, what did I see? Coming for to carry me home. A band of angels coming after me.
He was a theologian, a philosopher, a physician. He did a lot of amazing things out there in the world. And he said, sometimes our light goes out, but is blown again into instant flame by an encounter with another human being. Each of us owes the deepest thanks to those who have rekindled this inner light. This means we are social animals. We are not meant to be alone. That's why we come together every month through Memory Cafe to be together. Thank you, Beth, for all the years that you've been doing this since 7 years now, 7 years. I mean, Beth really brought Memory Cafe, what was second Memory Cafe in Massachusetts that Beth brought, and has really been a national leader in this, bringing folks together. And so, it's a reminder that he said this a long time ago. Sometimes our light goes out. We're not feeling great, but it's blown again into an instant flame by an encounter with another human being. That's we're meant to be here for each other. So with that, the song that speaks to that, this is Fannie Lou Hamer. She was very active in the civil rights movement. Awesome, awesome voice. Her story is unbelievable what she went through. Her last name is H-A-M-E-R. Worth Googling her. She went through a lot of trials and tribulations. So that's why we love this photo. Anyone think about what we will be singing with that has to do with light? Another civil rights song, This Little Light of Mine. And this song was written by Harry Dixon 100 years ago. Still singing it today. It was a big song of the civil rights movement. And it was recorded in the 1980s by Rafi, who I loved because he sang children's songs. And I used to sing Rafi songs with my kids when they were little. Also about this song is in the 1950s and 60s, once again, this became a civil rights anthem, and it was sung by the Seekers, And in 2006, one of my favorites, Bruce Springsteen, recorded this song. You can see I'm into rock and roll a little bit, so, you know. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. I'm gonna take this light around the world, I'm gonna let it shine. Light around the world, I'm gonna let it shine. Gonna take this light around the world and I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Next slide. I won't let anyone blow it out. I'm gonna let it shine. And I won't let anyone blow it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Won't let anyone blow it out. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. One more time. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Again, one more time. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Shine. I saw that Arnetta is back. Carl and Arnetta are back. Can you hear me? Oh, they're on mute, but I see. Arnetta, can you unmute? Can you unmute Arnetta? I don't know if she can hear me. Arnetta, wave if you can hear me. Arnetta?
Well, who knows? Sometimes we have glitches on Zoom, so
okay. Yeah. Well, I'm going to do it anyway. We're going to sing happy birthday to Arnetta because Arnetta had a birthday this week on November 2nd, and that's part of community and part of ritual. So let's join with me. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Arnetta. I love that, Sharon, that you have that happy birthday, and Lynn. Happy birthday to you.
That's great.
All right. Well, thank you all.
Yeah. You know, I was thinking of another thing about Fannie Lou Hamer. Just another example of the wisdom that comes with age. So she didn't become an activist till she was about 40. She was a sharecropper. She was the daughter of sharecroppers. And she really didn't have access to information about the rights that had now been passed by Congress. And when she found out, she became a force of nature. So she started her activism in midlife and immediately became so powerful because she was so sincere that even people who initially, you know, intended to disagree with her were won over by her. Like the president, LBJ at that time, was really afraid of her and her message. And once, when she was testifying before Congress and it was televised, he all of a sudden decided to hold a press conference at the exact same time because he didn't want people to watch her, But then he met with her and he was completely won over. So what an amazing woman who went through so much and who did so much for our country.
Wow, I love that, Beth. Thank you so much for sharing. We can take away the slides.
Okay.
I love that you shared that. So Beth and I work with older people, and now that I'm older, I like working with older people like I always did even when I was young. And I want to just add to that. I love what you said about she became an activist when she was middle-aged. Was during the time of the 60s, there was so much protest, civil rights against, you know, racism and sexism and ableism and homophobia. And there was also another term at that time that was coined, ageism, around the same time. And Maggie Kahn started the Gray Panthers in 1970. I don't know if anybody here of you has heard of the Gray Panthers. Well, Josh, you know, because I've talked. Anybody else here know about the Gray Panthers? Yes, Polly. Awesome. Awesome.
I see Judy nodding her head.
So she also became an activist when she was 65, and she was forced to retire from her job at a church. She was very upset because she had all this energy at 65. And so for the next 25 years, she became a force of nature as well. And it wasn't just working with older folks. She wanted to work with all the generations, young people in particular. And she really created this. And they cared about everything. Everything we care about today, she cared about. But also when she was much older, became a force.
Yeah. And then on the other end of the spectrum, I see Abby's grandchild is here in the picture in a little bouncy chair, which is wonderful to see. For those of you who can see all the little Zoom squares, Abby's grandson is there in the picture. And really, you know, in the end, what it's all about is all of us together, all the generations, because each individual has so much to offer, and generations have different gifts and different kinds of wisdom. So it's about bringing everybody together, not leaving anybody out.
Amen.
So Marjie, thank you. That was so beautiful. And